We are in section 20.9. So we will discuss another property of the Laplace transform. So basically, it's considered the product of two Laplace transform and found is. Inverse Laplace transform. It turns out to be a form of a convolution very similar to a Fourier convolution, but there's some differences. So we'll see what we'll get. So, so the Laplace transform two Laplace transform F1 is equals to Laplace transform of this capital F1. Then your F2 equals to Laplace transform of another function capital F2. Okay, so we are considering the product of F, this two Laplace transform. So by definition, this E minus S. So we'll actually use the integration variable instead of t for f1, f2, u, x, and y. So f1 x dx, and then e to the minus s y f2 y dy. Okay, so now we make a change of variable because you have two exponential functions. So you have minus sx minus sy. So you have combined x and y. So we can define now a new variable. Now going back to t is x plus y. And then we can then get rid of one of x or y. So if we in express x in terms of y, so we'll get, so instead of dx dy, we have dt dy, but then the limit need to be a little careful. So if this is original x and y, you're integrating over the whole space over here, but now t is defined by, if t is x plus y, so for a constant t is this line. So over this line, y is going from 0 all the way to t. So y is 0 here and y is t here because x is 0 here, so y is t here. So y, when t goes from 0 to infinity, then y will go from 0 to t. Okay, so change that. So you have dt from 0 to infinity exponential minus st, because combining these two exponential functions. Now you get rid of x, and so you have y only, so you integrate from 0 to t, and then f1 x is in terms of t minus y. f2y dy. Okay, and this integration now is a function of t, and we'll define that as the convolution. The label or the notation is f, again f star f1 star f2. So this is, but it's a little, the limit is different from Fourier transform. Fourier transform, we integrate from negative infinity to infinity, but this is 0 to t. That's f1, f2 function of t. Okay, so so what we now get is the inverse Laplace transform of f1. F2 will be this F1 one's the F2, which is defined as U to T dy F1 T minus Y F2 Y dy. So again, this the order of the convolution doesn't matter. You can see quite easily. This is the same as F2 star F1. So just exchange that and you can convince yourself that this is true. Okay, so so that is the convolution. It's somewhat different from Fourier transform or the Fourier convolution, although we are using the same notation, unfortunately. But just need to be a little careful when you do pay attention to whether you're doing Fourier transform or Laplace transform. So the convolution of the two cases are different. Similar but different. So one example to illustrate how you might use this convolution, whether you can get the situation where you have a convolution is this example, although you don't have to use Laplace transform to solve a situation that is not very complicated, not very difficult. So the example 20.9.1 is the case of a dam oscillator. So it's, you have x double prime plus b. So you have damping term, which is indicated by the parameter b. And then you have a k x. And then you have a forcing term f t. So for now, f, this capital F is unspecified. So later on, we'll specify that in a certain special cases. So we set initial condition x zero is zero, and x prime zero is also zero for the simplest case. All right, so all these are the Laplace transform of derivatives, we know that. So your m s squared times x plus b s times x. So it's little x is the Laplace transform of capital X plus k x equals to little f, which is which is the Laplace transform of capital F as usual. So this implies you can solve for the Laplace transform x in terms of the unknown function f s and divided by the m what we have done before. So what we have done last time is that we do just without the source term last time, we have do the complete square and get b over 2m in the square factor, and then plus this omega 1 square, and then omega 1 is defined by omega 1 square is omega 0 square minus b square over 4m square, or and then the omega 0 square is just the original frequency or angular frequency of the oscillator, so scale over m. Okay, so we have this formal solution. This is a little L. Not very key. Okay, so once you have that, you can do an inverse transform to get x. So xt would be equals to the inverse Laplace transform of this situation Fs, and whatever inside S plus B of 2m square plus omega 1 square. Okay, so now if the f, this little f is the Laplace transform of the capital F forcing function, and the Laplace transform of this 1 over this factor is also known, because last time we also did that when we consider problem without the forcing term, we calculate the solution by the inverse transform of this factor. So this is also a inverse transform of a given function. You get a damping solution for that one. So the inverse transform of F times this one becomes a convolution. And so the form of the convolution, you work out everything, is given by equation 20.193. So it's 1 over 2m. Omega 1 integrate 0 to TF T minus C. So this is the inverse Laplace transform of the little f, just like the original forcing function. And then the Laplace transform, the inverse Laplace transform of that factor will give you a damping term. Exponential minus b of m times t and sine omega 1 c. Actually, it's z, not t. Omega and z, t, c, because t is over here and then in the limit of the integration. Okay, so this formally, the solution of this problem can be written as a convolution between the forcing function and one of the solutions without the forcing term. So this is what we got last time. At least one of the equations you can get something like that, which is Laplace transform we're given by this factor. Okay, so formally we solved that, but to look at some of the special cases, the first case is when F is just an impulse. Ft is a constant p times delta t. Okay. So when you have a delta function here, so delta t becomes delta t minus z, and you integrate z, so all the z becomes t. So it becomes x t is equals to m omega 1. And there's a p coming out, p E minus B over 2MT sine omega T, omega 1T. Okay, so this is 20.194, and this one is 20.193. Okay, so this is a kind of trivial example, a trivial case with an impulse. So what you get, the solution is just like giving it an initial velocity, and then it's just decayed with this damping term in time, the exponential decay term, and then the oscillation term with frequency omega 1, which is modified by the from the original oscillation frequency with the damping term. Okay, so this is one case, and the other case is sinusoidal driving, so Ft equals to a constant F0 sine omega t, so you have a constant term. So, and we know that the Laplace transform of a sine, we know that, so Fs now is given by F omega S squared plus omega squared. Okay, so now this of course we put this into this also. We can also get a solution, but there will be kind of a little difficult. Now you have sine term will be t minus e. You have you need to use the you need to separate it into two terms. Okay, so the solution might be a little complicated. We'll go back to the original one. So before that, so we have this f going back to this f1 times f2. So this x little s, x is this one. So f, this is your f1, this is your f2. Okay, so x equals to this one, and then try to simplify that one, that final form. So we'll get to x equals to F term omega, this is F sub zero, F sub zero omega divided by M, and then you have the factor S squared plus omega squared, and then you have another factor, which is one over S plus P over 2M square plus omega 1 square. Okay. And so you can do a fraction, so partial fraction, and get some solve from some unknown coefficient, so it give you a separator of one over the term involving s square inverse f s square plus omega square. Another term is just the other term is s plus b over 2m square plus omega 1 square. Oh, there's some unknown coefficient, your a prime s plus b prime C prime S plus D prime, right? So all you need to do is solve for these four coefficients to satisfy. When you do a common denominator, you get back to this one. And the algebra is not difficult. And we don't have the space here to do all the algebra, but we probably won't do it here, but just write down the final answer. That the answer is kind of somewhat different from your textbook. I think your textbook may have missing an inverse factor somewhere. But let's just write, let me just write down my answer here. So what I have, a pine is the same actually. So we will write a pine, this implied a pine is minus b over m omega 0 square minus omega square plus b over m omega square. Okay. And then b prime is equals to omega 0 square minus omega square divided by the same factor omega 0 square minus omega square plus b over m times omega square. Okay, so this b prime is a little different from your textbook. So I think missing some inverse in your textbook, but anyway, the final answer is correct because now if we are just keeping this term, if you have c pi and d pi, because of this the denominator, because of the b over 2m in shifting this s dependence here, you will get exponential decay term just like this one. So this one will go away in time. So this is the first term will not go away, which will be keep being driven by the sinusoidal force. So this is kind of a quasi-steady state solution, which is still oscillating, but oscillating with the same frequency as the driving force. Okay, so we keep just this one and that one. And then you identify that the first one with the S is the inverse Fourier transform is sine omega t, the proportion is sine omega t, the second term proportion is cosine omega t. So you can just write down the inverse Fourier transform just for the first term. So xt is equals to f0 omega, right by all this coefficient. Okay, and then the first term with the a prime term will give you minus b over m cosine omega t, and the b prime term will give you omega 0 square plus minus omega square divided by omega sine omega t. Okay, and now you can do one more thing because the coefficient of this sine term and cosine term are similar to this, the two terms in the denominator. In fact, you can take the square root of this and the coefficient of this divided by the square of this becomes a sine and cosine function, and you can write that combine it as a single cosine function, a single sine function. Okay, so what you get is f0 over multiply things together. So so you still have a m here. Omega 0 square minus omega square plus p omega over m square 1/2, and then sine omega t minus phi. Okay, so so this phi is just basically this. This will give you the this divided by square root of that will give you the cosine phi And then this divided by square of this factor will give you sine phi. So all together will give you this one. Okay, so that is the solution. And you can figure out the at what frequency you get maximum amplitude. So the omega can change and depends on the omega 0 and b is a maximum amplitude. Okay, so this thing is oscillating according to the driving frequency, but the amplitude can change substantially, especially b is small. And this is the case close to the resonance. So to get to the largest amplitude, you need the smallest denominator. So if you do a simple derivative, so you take this omega squared, this omega squared. Do a derivative respect to omega squared, what you get is a minus. Minus the square term will give you 2 omega 0 square minus omega square, and then plus b over m square equals 0. So omega will be equals to omega square with the maximum one, the textbook defined as omega 2 square, would be equal to this divided by would be omega 0 square minus this one, because the omega square, right? This move to the other side, this move to the other side. So it gives you omega 0 square minus b over m square divided by 2. Okay, so this is omega 2 square. Okay, and this would be where you have the maximum amplitude, which the so-called Wesson condition. Okay, so all this is the example to look at where you have the a convolution getting out from Laplace transform. Okay, so this is section 20.9.